I remember how you told me that life may not be easy, and everything that I need, you've already given me. I remember how you told me I can trust you completely. So why am I doubting when you prove that you'd fight for me? You've walked me through fire, pulled me from flames. If you're in this with me, I won't be afraid. When the smoke billows higher, oh, winds higher, and it feels like I can barely breathe, I walk through these fires, 'cause you're walking with me.
Psalm 98, verse 4 says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth a joyous song and sing praises. And that's what we've come here to do, to lift up the name that is above every name. Can y'all help us out? Sing every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you that you have lifted us today, O God. We thank you, Lord, that in you we can place our hope and our trust today, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that when we were lost and in trouble, you sought us, you found us, you saved us, you delivered us, you healed us, and you set our feet upon a path that is straight and narrow, but it is sure and it is true. We ask, Lord, that in these days that we're living in, we would know the grace and the mercy and the strength and the power of your Holy Spirit in ways that we've never conceived of before. Father, we ask, Lord, that this would be a day of the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lord, that the works that are fashioned against us, O God, that they would not prosper, but that your church would stand victorious in every area, Lord, as you have spoken in your word. And so, Lord, we just release your power, your might, and your strength, Lord, in the atmosphere today. Lord, we release the anointing of your Holy Spirit to draw hearts unto yourself. Lord, we release your power to save, to heal, and to deliver those that are lost, sick, and bound. Father, we ask that today would be a day that mourning would be turned to joy. Lord, that the sorrow of heart would be turned to rejoicing. Lord, our hope and our trust is in you. We ask, O God, that you would have your way in the moments of these days, that you would be glorified in all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Good morning. I hope you're doing well. We are having a couple technical difficulties, we believe, with our cable provider. Our internet speed is not where it needs to be, so I don't know if you're watching me or not right now. But if you are watching and you're just getting little bleeps and bloops here and there, we will post the service a little bit later on from our recording. But if you're with me this morning, then I want you to know that this is the day that the Lord has made. And regardless of what happens around us, we will rejoice and we will be glad in it. Amen. This is a day that we should know that we are victorious and that we triumph in the name of the Lord. And that because we are called by His name, even though things may not go exactly as we plan, even though things may not be what we think they should be, we can know that the Lord is with us and He is always working His purposes together on our behalf. So this morning I want you to know, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, it is a good day. This is a good morning. This is the day that we have to honor our God and to worship Him. This is the day that we have to look to His Word for the direction of our life and to walk in the steps that He's ordained for us. And so with that in mind, we should be expecting that this is a day filled with hope and promise in the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to ask you to go ahead and take out your Bibles this morning. As you do that, I want to let you know that last week we started talking about marriage, and I said that we would follow that through for the next several weeks. I've decided to deviate from that plan this morning. I do have a message to husbands and a message to wives that I would like to present at another point in time. If I don't get to do it on a Sunday morning, I will upload it outside the Sunday morning stream. It will be available online one way or another. But this morning I want us to turn to Colossians chapter 1. That is Colossians chapter 1. And I want us to see a mystery revealed in this first chapter of Colossians. The book itself was written by the Apostle Paul to the believers in Colossae. He wanted to encourage and compliment them and assure them that they were moving with the Lord in the right direction. I don't know about you, but I am happy when someone can confirm to me that I am moving the right direction in my life, not just because I am building something here on earth, but because I'm keeping beat to the drumbeat of my God in heaven, and I am walking according to the principles of the kingdom of God. And I am seeing the kingdom of God established in me and through me. And so Paul was writing to assure these believers that they were moving in the direction that the Lord would have them to move in. He opens by saying that he has heard about their faith and about their love for one another. It is his spiritual enlightened perception that these qualities arise from their hope and the gospel. And I am sure that many have heard that the word gospel means good news. And you can be sure that we have good news when we have the gospel of Jesus Christ, when we have the truth that we are saved by faith in Him. That is good news for our life, and it absolutely changes everything. Paul sums up the gospel for them and for us in verses 13 and 14 of Colossians chapter 1. He says, "For God has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." Aren't you so glad today that if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that you have been rescued from the dominion of darkness and brought into the kingdom of the Son of God, the Son that the Father loves. And in that Son we have redemption and forgiveness of our sins. There should be something stirring within the heart of every man, woman, and child that has any inkling to the truth of that statement. When we begin to think upon the goodness of our God, when we begin to realize the glory of God revealed to us, that He has made known the riches of life eternal to us. He has brought us out of the dominion of darkness into the kingdom of His Son. Here Paul is talking about and to people who have crossed the line of faith and surrendered their lives to Jesus, believing that Jesus is who He says He is, and that having counted the cost, they are willing to follow Jesus wherever He leads them. Have you come to that point in your life yet? Not just you have a religious understanding of Jesus, but you have a dedication of your heart, your soul, your very life, that wherever my Jesus will lead me, there I shall follow. There is a world of difference between walking in relationship with God and walking in religion about God. This is particularly important because as we look at verse 27 of Colossians chapter 1 today, we need to understand that it applies to those who have crossed that line of faith. This is a message of hope for all who have made that faith journey, and is an invitation to those who still search for hope and security as they navigate the waters of life. Colossians chapter 1 verse 27. God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And I want to begin looking at that verse by going to the end of the verse. In fact, I want to go to the very last word, the word glory. Glory is one of those kind of words that we all have this understanding that we know what it means, yet if we were asked to describe it clearly, we would find it was a little bit difficult, especially when you begin talking about the glory of God. You know, if I were to ask you to describe this pulpit, you could likely do that very easily. You would tell me about its size, its shape, its color, its use, and so on. Most of us wouldn't have very much difficulty doing that. But if I were to ask you to sign something like the word beautiful, well, that gets a little bit more abstract and so a little bit more difficult. How would you actually define the word beautiful? After all, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. But yet there is something about that quality of beauty for us that when we look at something that is beautiful, we recognize it. We understand it. Now, I think that the word glory, especially in reference to the glory of God, is something like that. When we peer into the glory of God, we might not be able to put a whole bunch of words on it, but we see it, we know it, we understand it, and we recognize it. Then we must answer the question, what will we do with it? Now this morning I want to try and describe glory to you a little bit. I do not intend to give you a full theological description of every facet of the word glory. I just want to point out a few things that will help us to see its meaning and use here in Colossians chapter 1 verse 27. See, if you study the word glory, you'll notice that there are several words that seem to be attached to the word itself. And in fact, if you do a search through the scriptures, you will find that there's about 285 times that the word glory is mentioned. And I want you to know that's a whole lot of representation of a word if you don't really have an understanding of what it means. The first instance, or one of the first instances of the word glory, is found in Exodus chapter 15. And when we see it used there, it is in a song of worship written by Moses' sister Miriam. The word glory is often connected with the word majestic or majesty. Miriam sings, "Who among the gods is like you, Lord? Who is like you? Majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders." So when we think of God's glory this morning, I want us to think of His majesty. I want us to think of His dignity, His royal power, His beauty, beauty of His nature and character, the very beauty of who He is as a person. Another word that often shows up in conjunction with glory is the word splendor, from the word splendid, meaning magnificent, very impressive, excellent, or very good. In 1 Chronicles chapter 29, King David gives praise to God because the people have willingly given the resources needed to build the temple in Jerusalem. And verse 11 says, "Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours." One more word that I want to mention this morning connected to the word glory is strength. Psalm 96:6 says, "Splendor and majesty are before Him. Strength and glory are in His sanctuary." All three of our words are connected here in this one verse. Splendor, majesty, strength. All connected with the glory of God in His sanctuary. So when the Bible talks about God's glory, the idea conveyed involves majesty, splendor, and glory. The glory of God is the weightiness of His full presence. It is the complete goodness, beauty, and power of God. Now that can be a little bit hard to wrap our minds around. But if we just begin to think about the glory of God in terms of the weightiness of His presence in our midst, and we look into His goodness, His beauty, His power, His might, His strength, when His glory is revealed to us, it begins to give us a little bit of an understanding of what He's spoken about in this verse from 1 Colossians chapter 1. And we will get there in just a moment. But before we do, I want to give you just three things that will help us to understand God's glory in reference to His goodness, His beauty, His power, and so on, in reference to the verse we'll be talking about in a moment. And the first is this: God's glory is something that is to be displayed. You might wonder, what do I mean by that? Thank you for asking the question. If you were to take a ride up through the hill country in autumn, you would see the most amazing display of beauty in the autumn foliage. Or you might say that you see the glory of autumn because it is on display. In the same way that the glory of autumn is in display when you go for a ride through the hill country, the glory of God, His goodness, His beauty, His power, is something that is to be displayed to man and the universe. Psalm 19 verse 1 says, "The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display His craftsmanship." So the glory of God is to be displayed. Second thing I want us to understand: the glory of God radiates. It shines forth brightly. In the Old Testament, we find several examples. God calls Moses to approach Him on top of Mount Sinai for the confirming of the covenant. God's glory envelops the mountain. Exodus 27:17 describes what it looks like to the Israelites at the bottom of the mountain. If you read that verse in Exodus 24, verse 17 says that to the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on the mountain. So as they were down at the bottom of the mountain, looking up to the place where Moses had gone to meet with God, they see the glory of God consume the top of the mountain, shining forth brightly like a fire. It was radiating from the top of that mountain. It wasn't stagnant. It wasn't powerless. It was mighty and it was powerful, and it was shining forth or radiating forth. And the interesting thing is that when Moses came down off of the mountaintop after spending time with God, What do we know the scriptures say was his condition? But that his face was radiating. And I want you to know when the Israelites looked at him and his face was radiating from being in the presence of the glory of God, it freaked those people out. His whole face was glowing. It came to the point that they wanted to cover him with a towel. What was going on? The glory of God was reflecting in his face. Literally, it was radiating, a shining forth from him. So the glory of God is something that is to be displayed. The glory of God is to radiate. And third, when people see the glory of God, there's a right response to that. The honest heart bows down in praise and in worship. We see this in Luke chapter 2 at the announcement of the birth of Jesus. Verse 9 says, "An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified." Going down to verse 20 to save time, we read, "The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard." So the glory, the splendor, the majesty, the strength, the goodness, and the beauty of God, it is to be displayed. It is to radiate, and it is to cause people to come to a point of praise and worship, honoring the God who is the God above all gods. Okay, if you're still in Colossians, back to verse 27 of chapter 1. I want to add three words to the word glory. They're not my own words. They're the words of the scripture, so don't worry about it. Three simple words. The hope of. We put those together with glory. We have the end of the verse. The hope of glory. Just keep that thought in your mind for a moment. As the Old Testament closed and the New Testament opens, me might wonder, are the days of the world seeing the glory of God gone? We don't generally see literal fire fall and fill the sanctuary when the glory of God or his presence comes among us. Where is the hope that this world has that they can see the glory of God? Is there any hope that the unbelieving world would be able to see the goodness and the power of God on display? I want you to know the answer to that question is a resounding yes. Absolutely there is. Colossians 1:27 says that there is the hope of glory. How? Where can people see this hope of glory? And I want you to know, brother and sister, born again believer in Jesus Christ, in you, they can see that hope. And I want you to understand, it is not in us in our own strength, might, or power. It's not in our own ability, but it is Christ in us that brings the hope of glory for man to see the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Your life, your light for the Lord is not to be hidden. This is what Jesus says to us in Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 26. "You are the light of the world." Again, Jesus is speaking to those that have placed their hope and their faith and their trust in him. "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Do you see all the things that I've just been talking about here in this passage in Matthew chapter 5? The glory of God is to be displayed like a light put on a stand. Let it shine like a city on the hill. God's glory is to radiate from your life as it radiated from Moses' face. The presence of God is to emanate from within you. When it does, it causes people to respond to God by glorifying him, by praising him, and by worshiping him. Jesus living his life through you, Christ in you, that is the hope of glory. Christ in you, the radiating goodness of God, his strength and his beauty and his splendor. The majesty of Christ in you, believer, is the hope of glory. That's the mystery, the hidden or the secret thing, which the saints in the Old Testament didn't understand. God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Even us non-Jewish people, us Gentiles, we are included in God's plan to rescue the world. I don't know if you ever played tag when you were a kid, but I did. We would get together usually in the evening. And you know, first we used to play tag, you're it, but as we got a little bit older, the game kind of developed. And then we began having this system where if you got tagged, you had to go to the neighbor's house and sit on the front porch. You were basically put in jail. And you had to stay in jail until the game was over, or somebody from your team made it to jail, was able to step on the jail without getting tagged and yell jailbreak. When they yelled jailbreak, everybody that was out of the game was back in the game. Everybody came back to live play. And then kids would scatter with new life in every direction. And the people that were it trying to tag you would try and run crazy to try and apprehend you. Well, Jesus came to earth in essence to walk into the prison cells of man and yell jailbreak. Everyone can be free from the kingdom of darkness, even the Gentiles. No one saw that coming. Up to this point, most of the Jews thought that the Messiah was coming to reestablish Israel as a world superpower. For the most part, the Jewish people did not see Messiah coming to offer salvation to the whole world. But Jesus revealed that the kingdom of God is available to all who would come. The gates of the kingdom of heaven were thrown open wide. No longer are the sins of the people covered over by the blood of bulls and goats sacrificed at the temple, day in and day out, time and time again. Jesus come as the perfect Lamb of God, and His sacrifice doesn't just cover over, but it washes away the sins of those who believe and accept. He presented His body as a sacrifice once for all time. And then He sat down at the right hand of the Father, having proclaimed, "It is finished." Jesus revealed that which was previously hidden. The Jewish nation believed the Messiah would be a political, military leader and establish the kingdom of Israel. But the mystery that Jesus revealed was that He wasn't there to establish an earthly kingdom. Jesus came to bring the kingdom of God near. In fact, so near that it would be within those who would believe. When we cross over the line of faith and believe in our hearts and confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord, we are translated into the kingdom of the Son. We are participants in the kingdom of light. We are brought out of death, hell, and the grave, the kingdom of darkness. And we are to radiate the glory of God. Just like the verse from Luke, when the glory of God is displayed through our lives, the people around us will begin to be drawn into the presence of God and begin to worship God. I want to try and illustrate this for you. Maybe you've been looking at the figure over my head, the light bulb with a bunch of dots all around it. The light bulb, what does that represent? That represents you, believer. The dots represent people who know nothing of God's invitation to leave the kingdom of darkness and be transferred into the kingdom of light. Maybe this is a picture of your workplace. It could be that you're the only follower of Jesus there, and it is a dark, dark place. Maybe it's a picture of your home, because you're the only believer of Jesus that is resident in your household. It could be any place that God leads you, that you are among the lost. Because so often the church wants to cloister itself away in a place with other believers. And we don't care if it's just us four and no more, as long as the environment is what we want it to be, like a Christian Shangri-La. But I want you to know that the gospel was designed to go. And God wants us to bring the display of His glory into all the world. That means we're going to walk outside the doors of the church building, and we're going to go to places where the lost are. And sometimes, if not usually, we'll be one or maybe just one of the very few that know who Jesus is. That is the place that we're supposed to let our light shine the brightest. We are to radiate the glory of God, His presence, the weightiness of His person, His goodness, His splendor. We are to radiate the glory of God in those places. And then it is my belief that the scripture tells us as people look upon our lives and the glory of God radiating forth from us, that something begins to stir inside of them and they begin to be drawn unto the glory of God, Christ in you. The people in the place begin to notice that your life is different. You are free from anxiety in a time of high anxiety. You are full of peace when there is no peace around. Suddenly you're able to love, especially those that are unlovely, and you do it on a completely different level. As your life is radiating with the hope of glory, Christ in you, it draws someone to say, I want what you got. And then you need to be ready to give an answer for the hope that you have, for the glory of God that is within you, for Christ in you that is radiating forth from you. You see, this is what happens when the glory of God is displayed. Men are drawn to him. So oftentimes we try to use tactics and gimmicks to get people to the point where if we give them enough free stuff that maybe they might come to church. I want you to know that God does not want us to bribe people to come to church. He wants us to invite people by the glory of God revealed through our lives to be the church. Let your life radiate the hope of glory, which is Christ in you. You are to be the light of the world. So I say, let your light shine, even radiate. Wherever you find yourself today, would you allow yourself to believe that Christ has made you a new creature, a new person if you have been born again, the kind of person who displays peace instead of anxiety. You don't worry. Why? Because the Lord is your shepherd and you lack no good thing. The kind of person who is patient, not demeaning, not demanding, not trying to enforce that everyone else must operate on your timetable with your methods. You are kind. You do not return rude for the behaviors of others. You do not slander or gossip or rejoice in the suffering of others. You are able to demonstrate self-control, especially over your words, because your mouth is connected to your heart. And so with Christ in control of your heart, your words are the natural overflow of his control in your heart. Therefore, they are words that build up rather than tear down. Above all these virtues, you are to put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Above all else, you are to be known as a person who loves with the love of God, with the goodness of God, with the majesty and the glory of God radiating from you. You are generally to root for other people, even people that are hard to root for. Would you trust that God is displaying his splendor and majesty and beauty through you? Will you believe that the transformation of your soul is God at work displaying his might? Will you allow yourself to believe that God is doing something beautiful in you, that he might do something beautiful through you? It is not us on our own. It is Christ in us that is the hope of glory that this world needs to see. So let this mystery be revealed in and through you. So let your light shine among men that they might see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Let your face radiate with this mystery. In just a moment, we're going to sing the song, What a Beautiful Name. Because the name of Jesus is so beautiful. It brings joy to our hearts and our souls. I'm going to ask the singers to come forward as they get prepared to sing. I want you to prepare your heart to worship the Lord. I believe that the glory of God is being manifest in your home right now. If you are willing to open up your eyes and look with eyes of the Spirit, I believe that the glory of God is desiring to reveal to you truth and life abundant this morning. I said that this was a message to those who are believers in Jesus Christ, that you can be a vessel vessel in this moment of time when man is so open for any little resemblance of hope, that you can show to them the hope of glory that you have in Christ, Christ living inside of you, that you have been brought out of the darkness of the kingdoms of this world into the marvelous kingdom of our God, and that you live with hope and expectation. You live free from fear and doubt and anxiety about tomorrow, because you know who holds tomorrow. I also said that it was an invitation to those that don't know Jesus. Maybe you know about him, but that's as far as you ever let yourself go. Maybe you spent your whole life in church, but you know that you don't know Jesus in this way, that you don't know the hope or the glory of God's presence in your life. You can fix that right now. Jesus is calling all who would come to come to him, and to present themselves, to believe in their hearts and confess with their mouths that he and he alone is Lord. He will redeem you if that is your hope and your intention this morning. If you would just simply ask the Lord into your life, he would come, and by his Holy Spirit, he would dwell with you, and Christ in you would become the hope of glory to your family members, your friends, your co-workers, and larger community. But it all begins when we yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit of God. I believe this morning that God is drawing upon hearts. He is wanting you to respond to his glory. He's wanting you to see him in his goodness, his power, and his might, and respond to him. Would you do that this morning? Would you be willing to humble yourself before God and whoever's there with you watching this morning as well, and say, God, I come to you. Be my Lord, be my Savior. You have an opportunity right now to do that. Just before we sing the next few songs of worship, before we begin to declare how beautiful the name of Jesus is, I want us to pray. If you don't know Jesus Christ, or if you've backslidden and moved far away from him, I want you to know that today, if you will pray this prayer from the depth of your heart and confess it through your mouth, you will be born again. You will be renewed in Jesus Christ. You will have new life, and the hope of glory will be birthed within you. And then I want us all as believers in Jesus Christ to move forward today, wherever today brings us, and display the glory and the knowledge of God for all men to see, so that others will be drawn to him. Would you pray with me this morning? And say, Lord Jesus, I ask you, forgive me of my sins. I receive the work of Calvary in my life. I confess that I have sinned against you, but I ask that you would wash my sins away. I place my hope and I place my trust in you. Amen. Father, I pray for myself. I pray for those that have prayed that prayer this morning. I pray for my brothers and sisters that have been walking with you, that today would be the first day of the rest of our eternity. That today, Lord, we would hold it in our hearts and our minds that we are to display your glory for man to see. It is to radiate from our lives that when man sees how good you are, how glorious you are, that their only right response, their only honest response would be to be drawn to you and confess you as Lord and Savior. I thank you today, Lord, and ask that you would seal this work in the hearts, the minds, and the souls of your sons and daughters. I know that the devourer will come moments from now and seek to persuade those that are purposing to follow you from allowing the seed of your word to take root in their heart and soul and grow into a mighty tree of faith. Lord, I come against that enemy this morning in the name of Jesus, and I command him to be gone from the people of God. Father, I know that you hold them safe in your hand today. Lord, I pray, breathe the life upon them afresh and anew this morning, that they might walk in power and in might, that they might destroy the works of the evil one. through the hope of glory in them, which is Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I invite you to stand to your feet this morning and worship the Lord. He is beautiful beyond all description. Worship Jesus. God bless you.
Victory, I'm gonna see a victory for the battle.